How do you know when something is moving towards you or away from you? Well, depending on the object and the person observing, we can typically rely on sensory cues, like seeing the object get larger or hearing it get louder. In astronomy, we say that an object coming towards us is blueshifted, while an object moving farther away is redshifted. Why? Well, it all has to do with frequency and wavelength. Here, I'll explain. I feel like an astronaut in what you know about rolling down in the deep. Let's say two people are having a verbal conversation. If person A walks towards person B while they are conversing, person B will hear person A's voice get louder. This is because the frequency of the sound waves being emitted will appear to increase as person A gets closer. Conversely, if person A walks away from person B while they are speaking, the frequency of the sound waves will appear to decrease, and thus person A's voice will be harder to hear than before. Of course, if person A is facing away from person B, their voice will no longer be traveling in a straight path towards B, and will thus be diluted by other objects in the environment. However, this effect will occur even if the two are facing each other and A moonwalks away. This apparent change in wave frequency as a source moves towards or away from an observer is known as the Doppler effect. The same increase and decrease in frequency happens with light waves. When a source moves towards an observer, its apparent frequency will increase. We call this blue-shifted because blue light has the highest frequency in the visible spectrum. When a source of light moves away from an observer, its apparent frequency will decrease. We call this red-shifted because red light has the lowest frequency in the visible spectrum. Okay, cool. Why do we care? Well, for one, the Doppler effect allows us to determine whether or not we are moving closer to or farther away from other celestial objects. We know the Milky Way will eventually collide with the Andromeda galaxy, for example, because we observe Andromeda's frequency increasing relative to us. It is being blue-shifted. The Doppler effect also helps us determine the direction a galaxy is moving. For example, if the left-hand side of a galaxy is blue-shifted, moving towards us, while the right-hand side of a galaxy is moving away from us or red-shifted, the galaxy will be moving counterclockwise relative to us. By contrast, if the right-hand side is blue-shifted while the left-hand side is red-shifted, the galaxy must be moving clockwise relative to us. To figure out how much an observed frequency has increased or decreased, let's consider a wave of light. Light moves at a speed of c, and we'll call its base wavelength lambda naught. Now, to be clear, this little circle here is a zero, not an O, which stands for the intrinsic wavelength, not the observed. The total length of the wave that travels over time t will be c times t. If the source of light moves away from us at a speed of v, the wave will appear stretched out, leaving us with an observed wavelength of lambda. The additional length that was added to the wave over the same time t will be v times t, making the total length of this observed wave ct plus vt. Now, we can say that the change in the wavelength, that is lambda minus lambda naught, compared to our initial wavelength is equal to vt over ct. And of course, we can simplify this by crossing out the t's. I would strongly recommend writing down this equation for when you need to use the Doppler effect. I'd also suggest seeing if you can derive the equation on your own or rewatching the last, 15 to 30-ish seconds of this video if you get stuck. Now, sometimes you will see the equation written in a different format, so let's write it in a different way just so you can see how we get there. We can rewrite the left-hand side of our equation as lambda over lambda naught minus 1. We can then add 1 to both sides of our equation to get a ratio for the observed wavelength over the initial wavelength. Lastly, to isolate our observed wavelength on one side of the equation, we can multiply both sides by lambda naught. In the earlier sections of this video, I talked about the Doppler effect primarily in terms of frequency, so here's an easy trick to switch from talking about wavelength to frequency. Since frequency is inversely proportional to wavelength, all we have to do to put our equation in terms of frequency is take the inverse. Now we have two more equations to describe the Doppler effect, but remember, they all stem from the same math, so you should be able to easily get from one to the other. Okay, time to work with some numbers. Let's assume a star peaks at 600 nanometers. It's moving away from you at 1/100th the speed of light. What wavelength would you observe the star to peak at? Well, the star is moving away, so that tells us that the star is redshifted, which means we should expect to observe a smaller frequency, or larger wavelength, than the star actually has. It's moving at 1/100th the speed of light, so V over C is 1/100. The intrinsic wavelength we know to be 600 nanometers, so the change in wavelength is 1 over 100 times 600 nanometers, or 6 nanometers. The change in wavelength is lambda minus lambda naught, so lambda equals 600 nanometers plus 6 nanometers, 606 nanometers. That's the wavelength that we observe, and as expected, it's larger than the star's intrinsic wavelength of 600 nanometers. So great, everything checks out. Well, that's about all for today's video, so thanks for watching, and as always, ponder, wander, and go right in the stars. Slow motion, yeah. I feel like an astronaut in the ocean, like, what you know.